Brian Fargo had gone through high school playing games on his Apple II. But after graduating, he decided that he could probably make better games than the ones he was buying. So in 1982, he programmed the Demon's Forge, using the company name Saber Software. He was all on his own, so in order to sell it, he spent half his budget on one single ad in the computer magazine Soft Talk. Then, to get retailers to want it, he would call up stores pretending to be a random gamer who wanted to play the cool game they'd seen in Soft Talk. The trick worked, and retailers started ordering the game from Saber Software, not knowing Saber was one person, and that it was the same one person who'd called them in the first place. The game got him the attention of Boone Corporation, where he went to work for the next year. But after one of Boone's board meetings ended in a fist fight, Fargo decided it was time to strike out on his own again. So he gathered together some friends and founded his own company in 1983. They went ahead with no real plan, having no idea that they were about to experience one of the most dramatic rises and precipitous falls in the history of their industry, going from small developer to top-level publisher to bankrupt, while at the same time giving major developers like Blizzard, BioWare, and Treyarch their start. Sit back and enjoy this bard's tale of Interplay Entertainment. In the early days, Interplay didn't do anything too exciting. They ported already existing games to other platforms and even did some work for a military subcontractor. Finally, they landed a deal with Activision to do some original games. Their first product was Mind Shadow in 1984, an adventure title based loosely on the novel The Bourne Identity by Robert Ludlum. The game, which required players to piece together their forgotten past, was a modest success and was a good start for Interplay as an original developer. And only a year later, Interplay produced its first major hit. Tales of the Unknown Volume 1, The Bard's Tale, was a role-playing game heavily inspired by the Wizardry series, which themselves perfectly utilized the Dungeons & Dragons rule set, albeit without an official license to do so. The Bard's Tale was much more sophisticated, adding in color, sound effects, and music to make the D&D experience that much more immersive. While the story was pretty bare bones, its famous intro sequence featured a bard recounting a tale that the gamers would then play through. And like Wizardry before it, The Bard's Tale featured an addicting blend of gathering loot and leveling up. Additionally, the game was expertly marketed by their new publisher, a young upstart called Electronic Arts. When all this was said and done, The Bard's Tale sold 300,000 copies. Incredible for 1985. It turned Interplay from a no-name developer into a major industry player. The Tales of the Unknown was always meant to be a series, but the game's success had come with an unexpected problem. Everybody just called it Bard's Tale. Interplay had wanted to follow the game up with The Archmage's Tale and Thief's Tale. But now, EA told Interplay that their sequels would have to be known as Bard's Tale 2 and 3, even though that had never been their intention. Still, EA proved it knew what it was doing as the later Bard's Tales games went on to be successes in their own right. Interplay was on a roll now, and like most developers of the late 80s, were putting out several games a year. 1988 saw the third Bard's Tale and Neuromancer, based on the famous cyberpunk novel by William Gibson. But the biggest Interplay game of 88 was Wasteland. A morally ambiguous post-apocalyptic RPG set in the southwestern United States, it was unlike any other game of the time. It featured a gigantic world that the player could explore as he willed, instead of being a linear experience. It had a rich storyline and a large cast of characters. Dungeons wouldn't reset every time you visited, and it would remember each enemy you killed or puzzle you solved. But most importantly, the game wasn't split into simple good and evil, like every other RPG. Choices were varying shades of gray, and sometimes players would find themselves in darker situations than other games dared go. It was another big success for Interplay, but it was still published by EA. But by 1988, the developer had decided that they didn't want anybody else telling them what to do anymore. Only 5 short years after their founding, Interplay decided to self-publish. So all on their own, they released Battle Chess, which was just chess, but with the one thing that every other chess game was missing: violence. Instead of simply capturing an opponent's piece, the fully realized sprites would duke it out for control of their square. It might not seem like much, but it grabbed audiences' attention and became a seller for Interplay. So as the 80s turned into the 90s, Interplay seemed to be sitting on top of the world. Brian Fargo and his team had grown the company into an RPG powerhouse that could successfully self-publish. There was only one last frontier to conquer: publishing games from other developers. That was, after all, where all the real money was, as they'd learned from watching Activision and EA take a chunk of their own game's profits. Now it was their turn, and they went for broke. Since the gaming industry was still relatively young, Interplay decided to gamble on a number of unestablished but talented young teams. One of the first was a group of three college grads calling themselves Silicon and Synapse. In 1991, Interplay published RPM Racing, which was the first American-made game for the Super Nintendo. This was a big deal for Interplay, since to date they'd only seen major successes on PCs. If they could make that jump to consoles, they'd be one of the biggest powers in the industry. Over the years, Silicon and Synapse would create a number of console products such as The Lost Vikings and Rock'n' Roll Racing. Eventually, Interplay offered to acquire the little company outright. Sadly, the guys, now named Blizzard Entertainment, chose to go elsewhere. Interplay wouldn't know how much they'd lost until later. In the meantime, Interplay was still doing great work as a developer. In 1992, they obtained a license to do a game based on the original Star Trek series. This wasn't considered that big a deal. The show had been off the air for decades, and the follow-up series, The Next Generation, was what all the kids were watching now. But in terms of both commercial sales and critical praise, Star Trek 25th Anniversary ended up being the first successful Star Trek video game. For a later CD-ROM version, Interplay even reunited the original cast to the show to do the voices. Not too bad for a couple of video game nerds. Throughout the 90s, they continued their trend of giving talented young companies their start. In 1995, they published Descent by Parallax Software. Descent was considered a Doom clone at the time, though in fact it was more of a successor to the games that inspired Doom, like Wing Commander. With full six-axis controls, engaging graphics, and addicting multiplayer, Descent became an underground hit. Parallax later split into Outrage and Volition, and Volition continued to publish through Interplay for several years. The games of their Free Space series are considered some of the finest space sims ever produced. Then in 1996, Interplay published a pair of mech games that never really caught on. Max was produced internally as the company's first entry into the strategy genre. This genre had suddenly become popular after the release of Westwood Studios' Command & Conquer. Max was similar in many ways, except that it was turn-based instead of real-time. That said, it garnered very positive reviews, with many critics stating that Max was actually better than Command & Conquer. Unfortunately, gamers didn't feel the same way, and the product didn't sell very well. That same year, Interplay released the mech combat game Shattered Steel, but it, too, never really got off the ground. Maybe that's not so surprising, since it was the first game from a couple of med students with no background in entertainment. Nevertheless, Interplay stayed on good terms with the guys who called themselves BioWare. Little did they know, this group of doctors in Canada would end up being their most important relationship. But in 1997, Interplay had their sights on another company that they hoped would push them into the top echelon of publishers. Shiny Entertainment had attained global success with their Earthworm Jim games, which had spun off into toys, t-shirts, and a Saturday morning cartoon show. They were currently at work on their next franchise, MDK, and the hype behind it was at fever pitch. It was a surefire hit if there ever was one. So Interplay didn't just sign the publishing rights, they bought the whole company. So after years of buzz and massive press attention, MDK finally released, to only middling sales. While it wasn't a flop, it was a disappointment. Later, Interplay would once again try to dominate the console space with Shiny's Wild 9, but this game, again, disappointed. So it seemed that Interplay was consigned to the PC, even though more and more dollars were moving away from that platform and towards consoles. But even amidst the bad news, Interplay still had a few titles to write home about. Carmageddon from Stainless Games was a wild racing game that threw acceptability to the wind. Players gained points for running over pedestrians and destroying enemy cars, and featured a loose interpretation of the laws of physics. But gamers loved it. 1997 had one other major game of note, a throwback to their old Wasteland series. EA still held the rights to that franchise, so Interplay built a new one from the ground up. The result was Fallout. Like Wasteland, it was a post-apocalyptic RPG that eschewed traditional morality. Once again, the player was faced with some grim decisions with no upside, but with a sense of arid, dry humor that somehow made it all hysterical. The art design was a throwback to 1950s Pulp Fiction, with robots, ray guns, and cathode ray tubes. The world was open for the player to explore, the level-up system was deep and accessible, and the characters were memorable. It also had an astounding voice cast for games of the era, including Richard Dean Anderson, Keith David, Tony Shalhoub, and Ron Perlman as the narrator. Like Wasteland before it, it was a sensation with audiences. And yet, in terms of sales, it couldn't compete with console juggernauts like Final Fantasy VII. It was like no matter how hard they tried and how well they were reviewed, they just couldn't sell like their competitors. And now, the cracks were starting to show. By this time, Interplay was a monster, publishing roughly as many games as Activision or EA. That's an extremely expensive business, but Interplay lacked the sales to justify it. Successful PC games just weren't matching successful console games in terms of revenue. If Interplay couldn't find a console hit soon, or at least get more games to turn a profit, they'd be in serious trouble. They had no idea how bad it was about to get. In its first 15 years of existence, Interplay Entertainment went from pipe dream to dominant industry publisher. Under the leadership of their founder Brian Fargo, they made a number of highly successful role-playing games like The Bard's Tale and Wasteland. They leveraged this success to begin a publishing business, beginning with their own battle chess and soon expanding to include titles from other developers, including the very first games of Blizzard and BioWare. By 1998, they were putting out as many games as other powerhouses like Activision or Electronic Arts, both of whom had once been Interplay's publishers. To outsiders, they were the envy of every startup, the handful of kids who built an empire while making games they loved. But even in these heady days, Interplay was standing on thin ice. Publishing is a hugely expensive business, and is only profitable if the label produces a number of major hits. Unfortunately, even big sellers like Interplay's own Fallout weren't making up the deficit. And even though their biggest franchise was only just around the corner, it was too late to save Interplay from itself. With the money he'd been making, Fargo had become an art collector, and had grown to be a fan of painter Gil Bruvel. So when Fargo found out that Bruvel did 3D computer art as well, something clicked in his head. Why not reach out to Bruvel to see if he wanted to do the art for a point-and-click adventure? It would be a chance to do a much more mature game with ties to literature, mythology, and religion. The game could deal with sophisticated themes like sin and redemption, while at the same time flipping established conventions on their heads. In short, it could dare to push the video game medium from child's toy into high art. It didn't. 1998's Of Light and Darkness: The Prophecy was a confusing, pretentious mess that only alienated what few gamers played it. Critics said that there were some genuinely good ideas in it and appreciated its attempt to push the medium's boundaries, but none of that could make up for a convoluted story and repetitive gameplay mechanics. Needless to say, it didn't sell very well. Before its release, the game had gone through two different developers, hired Hollywood talent to do the voices, and paid for all of Bruvel's artwork. In other words, it cost a lot of money, but didn't make a lot of money. It was indicative of Interplay's larger problems. They were reaching too far, trying to do too much with too little to support them. They were genuinely trying to promote innovative content, but it wasn't working. Earlier that same year, they published Die by the Sword from a brand new developer called Treyarch. The game employed a rudimentary form of motion control, effectively turning the mouse into the player's sword arm. Move the mouse, swing the sword. Unfortunately, the controls were wonky and the big feature came off as little more than a gimmick. Once again, gambling on something fresh had turned out sour. So it was with all this happening that Interplay finally decided to go public. In retrospect, it probably wasn't the best time for an IPO, but these things take years to set up and once the ball is rolling, it's tough to stop. In June of 1998, Interplay opened up its shares for anyone to buy. They were hoping to raise some desperately needed capital with the IPO. But much like their games, their shares did not sell like expected. Initially hoping to earn $8 to $10 a share, the market closed for the day at $6 per share. Investors had heard about the underperformers and were being cautious. It was the opposite of what Interplay needed. Ironically, only a few months later, Interplay would release a number of hits, including the single biggest success Interplay would ever have. In September, Interplay published Fallout 2 from Black Isle Studios. Who is Black Isle, you ask? It was actually the exact same Interplay team that had made the original Fallout, but now they had their own brand name. Black Isle would go on to create a number of big games, mostly set in the Dungeons & Dragons universe. As for Fallout 2, it was little change from its predecessor, except that it was bigger. And like its predecessor, it was only a modest success, not enough to turn Interplay's woes around. Then, in November 1998, Interplay published the second game from BioWare. Their first game, Shattered Steel, had not done very well. But they'd learned from their first endeavor, and their current one was set in the D&D universe, so there was some hope that it would sell better. As it turned out, Baldur's Gate was to become the biggest franchise Interplay would ever have. Where Shattered Steel had been relatively light on story, Baldur's Gate was a sweeping epic populated by fantastic characters in a gigantic and fully explorable world. Gameplay was fast-paced and fun while still being tactical, and D&D fans found that everything perfectly conformed to the rules they knew. Word of mouth spread quickly, and before they knew it, the doctors from Canada had produced a phenomenon. And still, it wasn't enough. The complex controls of Baldur's Gate couldn't map over to consoles, which meant that Interplay still couldn't penetrate gaming's most profitable sector, which meant that, for all the good Baldur's Gate did, Interplay still had to post a loss for the quarter. And things only went downhill from there. 1999 saw unexpectedly poor performances from Descent 3 and Free Space 2, probably because they were two similar games that released right on top of each other. As if fate had conspired against them, they then published Zatrix Entertainment's gritty crime game, Kingpin, just after the Columbine High School shootings, leading to the game getting pulled from major retailers like Walmart and Best Buy. Interplay also had a few canceled projects and were restructuring the company. Altogether, it meant that they posted an even bigger loss in 99 than they did in 98. The years went by with a few more successful titles, like Baldur's Gate 2 and MDK2 from BioWare, and Planescape Torment and Icewind Dale from their own Black Isle. But they still published more games that disappointed than did well. Eventually, something had to give. In 1999, the French technology firm Titus Interactive had bought a large amount of stock in Interplay. In 2001, they increased it to a controlling share. Now that Titus made all the decisions and had pumped some cash into Interplay's coffers, it was hoped that things might finally turn around. Instead, it was the beginning of the end. Titus's founder and CEO was Hervé Kahn, and once his company had control, he became Interplay's new president. His first act as overlord was to shut down their publishing arm. From then on, Interplay would just be a developer, with Vivendi publishing their games. This kicked them down from industry superpower status. Of course, since they'd been losing money hand over fist as a publisher, it was probably the right move. Unfortunately, Kahn did not get along at all with Interplay's founder, Brian Fargo. In January 2002, only a few months after Kahn's takeover, Fargo left the company. He'd been effectively excluded from the decision-making process, and he had no urge to be a bystander in his own company. Cast into self-imposed exile, he went on to found a new studio, the aptly named In Exile Entertainment. Interplay had now cut off the biggest tie to its past, so maybe it's not surprising that they quickly began cutting off the rest. Still desperate for cash, Kahn started selling off Interplay's intellectual properties, a practice he would continue for years to come. First up, in April 2002, he sold MDK developer Shiny Entertainment to Infogrames for $47 million, along with the rights to make video games based on the Matrix series of films. The money was good, though of course losing Shiny was a blow. Unfortunately, Interplay was then sued by their former golden boys, BioWare. Now that they were no longer a publisher themselves, Interplay under Kahn had tried to sublicense the publishing of BioWare's games to other people, without asking BioWare about it. Furious, BioWare sued. At the same time, both BioWare and Parallax, the makers of Descent, sued Interplay for unpaid royalties. The case was eventually settled out of court, and as part of the deal, Interplay would no longer be involved with BioWare's next game, Neverwinter Nights. Not enough bad news for you? Alright, how about Interplay's stock being delisted from NASDAQ in October 2002 because it was trading for under a dollar? Or how about in 2003 when Interplay got sued by its own publisher, Vivendi, for breach of contract? Or the fact that they were still posting losses quarter after quarter? Finally, the inevitable arrived. In December 2003, Interplay shut down Black Isle Studios, its own development house. At the time, the studio had just finished Baldur's Gate, Dark Alliance 2, and were currently working on the next Fallout game, codenamed Van Buren. However, a large number of Black Isle employees had seen the end coming and had already left to form their own company, Obsidian Entertainment. The Obsidian guys immediately got in touch with their old BioWare buddies and quickly got to work on a sequel to one of their games. The result was 2004's Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic 2. So now, Interplay was a video game company that neither developed nor published anything. What they did have were the rights to various properties, including Earthworm Jim, MDK, Baldur's Gate, Fallout, and many others. So the only way they could make money anymore was by either selling or licensing out those properties. How much worse could it get?